So this is Elixir. It's not just for the Rubyists. That might be a little offensive to some of the people here, but let me see if I turn this bad boy on. It would help. So this is going to be an entry to medium level discussion about Elixir. You don't have to have programmed it before, but it probably helps if you're familiar with, you know, general programming concepts. But feel free to stop me at any time and I'll do my very best to answer any questions you might have. So what are we here for? This evening I'm going to give you a fairly high level tour of the language itself, a wee bit of background on its history, capabilities, that sort of thing, as well as some information about the Erlang environment in which Elixir lives. So we'll spend a little bit of time going through some of the major features of the language, and I'll try and relate these back to familiar concepts and other languages that you may have already worked with. And since everyone loves to participate in holy wars about text editors, I'll spend a wee bit of time talking about how you can write Elixir code and get started yourself. Before going any further, I'll introduce myself. I'm Maurice Kelly, or Mo, in the NI Tech Slack. I've been writing code, I was going to say professionally, I went ahead and said it, since 2001, and I've programmed in a few languages over the years, but I'm fairly relatively new to Elixir. I became interested in it about 2 or 3 years ago when I watched it was a peep code video with the creator, Jose Valim, and I just got really interested at the time, and I don't know if it was his passion for it or what it was, but something really sort of inspired me to start looking into it. But it's only recently that I've actually found the time to do it. So one question you might have, it might be about the title of the talk. Why am I picking on Rubyists? I mentioned Jose Valim just a few seconds ago, and Jose was a member of the Ruby on Rails community, and as a result, it's kind of natural that Elixir will be influenced by both his experiences with Rails and working with Ruby. So the influence is probably most striking in the style of the language. So there's usually a healthy sprinkling of keywords like def and do and end and puts and or put s, and especially the widespread use of atoms. So it's if you were looking at Ruby and Elixir side by side from a great height, they probably look very similar. And these factors have made Elixir very popular for Ruby developers to start experimenting with different concepts like more concurrent languages or functional languages. Don't get me wrong though, I don't think badly of Rubyists, and some of my best colleagues program in Ruby, and they are functioning, although not functional, members of society. But just because Elixir is a popular destination for Rubyists doesn't mean that there isn't room for the rest of us to get in there too. So, what is Elixir? It's a modern, functional, concurrent language built on top of the Erlang VM. It was created by a Rails contributor called Jose Valim, and he decided one day that he wanted something that was more performant and functional, and it had to be concurrent out of the box than Ruby. While he was working for his company, a Brazilian consultancy called Platformatech, he spent some R&D time developing Elixir. So what makes it interesting? It's a compiled language, although it doesn't compile down to native code. Instead, it compiles to bytecode that can be run on the Erlang VM. There are two things developers usually think about when they hear the term VM. Virtual machines that run inside the likes of VMware or VirtualBox, and then there's the Java virtual machine, or JVM. So which one is the Erlang VM then? It is a VM in the same vein as the JVM, but it doesn't run Java code. The Erlang VM, or Beam as it's known, was created by the telecoms company Ericsson many years ago. It's a very well-established environment for running bytecode that was initially created to run applications written in the Erlang programming language itself. Like the JVM, the Beam can run any valid bytecode regardless of the language in which it was created. Or programmed, or the type of machine it was developed on. So you can use a number of languages, or you can program from a number of different OSs and stuff. And as long as your code is the right kind of bytecode, it will run in the Beam. And this works in the same way that, for example, you can write code in, write your applications in Clojure or Scala or Kotlin and compile those down to bytecode that you can run on the JVM. This is great because it allows for a degree of mixing and matching between Erlang and Elixir. You can import your external dependencies in that are written in Erlang into Elixir, and you can even call Elixir code from your directly from your Elixir source. And the Erlang VM itself is a tried and tested architecture, and it favors concurrency and distribution. And it's got a great legacy that draws from a need for stability for when it was initially designed for the use on telephone switches. Unlike some compiled languages, Elixir is actually dynamically typed. This gives us a lot of flexibility at runtime without really having to worry as much about the type of data you're going to be receiving. It is strongly typed though, so even though you are determining the type at runtime, once that's been determined, you can't change it. That said, it doesn't mean that you can't make it safer at compile time and runtime. So Elixir features test functions such as isNumber or isMap or isList, so you can determine what the data type you're actually currently working with. And that lets you customize your code by creating different data paths within a function, or even different functions or different variations on the same function. Elixir also supports type specs, which allow you to then document your source code, so you can add specifications to the function, the parameters that your functions are receiving, and the types that they're returning as well. And when you use that with it's the Dialyzer and Dialixir tools, then you're able to perform static analysis on your code, which gives you that little bit of extra confidence. So one of the original drivers for Jose Valim was to produce a functional language. Now, the concept of functional programming is not new, but it's definitely acquired a great amount of interest in recent years. And Elixir is a great way to get into it if you want to dip your toes in the functional water. I'm not an expert in what constitutes a truly functional language, so I'm going to probably leave that sort of definition to experts. Maybe somebody like Stephen would be able to tell us a bit more. But for me, what makes Elixir functional is the fact that it treats functions as first-class citizens. It allows them to not only be assigned two variables, but then you can also pass functions as parameters to other functions and return functions from your functions. But one thing that sort of sums it up for me is the fact that once you've entered a function, you can't change anything outside that function, really. You can use the values that are passed into the function. You can return a value, but as far as your code is concerned, that's its world. You know, what's in there is what it knows about. Elixir is most definitely not object-oriented. In OO, you would use classes in order to sort of pull together your state and the functions that act on that state. But in Elixir, there is no state, there is only functions. So we now get down to the nitty gritty of the language. I'm gonna walk through some of the main features and show some example syntax and maybe do a few comparisons with other languages. Functions are the building block of Elixir. You could write all your Elixir code if you wanted as one huge file and do everything as a linear script, but eventually you're going to get really tired of having repetitive code that you've inlined and that should really have been a function instead. Some languages are kind of strict about how you define functions. So we've got an example here from Java where you have to specify the types of your inputs to the method or the function, and you have to tell it what type it's returning, and you even have to say that you're returning at that time. With Elixir, you can see a bit of the Ruby heritage there, where there's an implicit return at the end. You don't have to specify the types that you're passing in. A and B could be strings, they could be numbers. It doesn't matter as far as we're concerned right now. And we also don't say what type you're returning. A nice feature of the functions is that they can include their own conditions. So for example, if you wanted to handle the summing of the two numbers from the previous example slightly differently, you can do it like this, where in this case I've written the same function, but I've added a clause that says when A equals B, I want to actually just multiply A. Now, very simple example, but it shows that, you know, you can actually have different paths of execution. You can call different variations of your functions depending on what the parameters you're sending in are. Now, it won't take long before you start writing all these functions and they get out of control, and you're going to need some organization. OO languages will rely on class for this kind of organization, but Elixir instead relies on modules. So our summing function from before, it may belong in a module that with other, some other simple math functions, and I realized I've used the American math, sorry about that. So we can use the def module construct to create the module for that. It's worth noting that you can nest your modules as well. So you can nest them directly in code like this, or you could put them next to each other like this, where you're sort of using the same sort of syntax or same prefix to indicate that they're kind of related. Now, in reality, this is just a visual convenience. The modules have effectively the same prefix, but and to you, they have related behaviors. You know these are all parts of your simple math module, but to the compiler, it doesn't matter. The module name is the entire path, which is what I'm just saying. Elixir, everything is immutable. This is a great thing because it means you can be pretty confident that a variable has exactly the same value that you expect it will have. So say you have an array variable in Swift and you wanted to append a value to it. Well, when you print out that original array, you will find that that has been changed. In Elixir, on the other hand, you take an array, you add a value to that array, and the original array is still the same as it was before. The result of the expression array plus plus four is a new array with that with the extra element, but that's not what you haven't done anything with that. You can do something with it. You can then reassign it to the array variable. So you can rebind variables, that's fine, but the original one has never been changed. And that means that you can't have two portions of your code modifying the same variable. Pattern matching, if you're anything like me when pattern matching was introduced to Swift, you might find it really easy to conflate the concept of pattern matching with the regular expression match operator in something like Perl. So pattern matching in Elixir is similar to that of Swift, but I think it goes even further and it's just that bit more powerful. It's all based on this match operator, which is the assignment operator in most languages. We have examples here. So the first example there, we have a tuple where the tuple on the right is contains 1, 2, and 3, and the tuple on the left are some variables. So we will actually use that pattern matching. Those will match, and we can then assign the result, or we can assign a=1, b=2, and c=3. So it's pretty pervasive in Elixir, and it's got a lot of ramifications for things like function execution. So you can change what type of function you're going to execute, or you can use case statements and message passing, and lots more. So case statements, if statements are available in Elixir, but they're only really intended to be used for like single condition checking. You can do else's, but it's sort of like, why bother when you've got case instead? So we've got this convoluted expression in Swift, and I keep going back to Swift because that's the language I'm most familiar with these days. So it is a little bit convoluted and contrived, but in this case, we have a special condition where no matter what anything else is, if a=1, we want to return true. We have another condition where if a=2 and b>1, we want to return true, or else we want to return false. With the case statement in Swift, we get to use pattern matching. So we're passing in a tuple at the start that's A and B. The first condition, or the first case, says if we've won and the underscore represents anything, we'll match that as true. In the second case, we want, if a=2 and we have assigned the second variable to B or to X, and then we use a condition to say when X is greater than 2, we'll return true. And then at the third condition, we've used the underscore again to say it doesn't matter what was passed into the case statement, we're going to do false. And so far, it just seems like a slicker form of conditional logic, which it kind of is. But where it really shines for me is in the function definitions. So we saw an example of this earlier, where we have the sum of two numbers when A equals B. So that's handy. But say you wanted a further specialization of your summing function where, you know, if you're adding zero as the second number, well, you're going to be getting A back effectively. So we can actually do, the bottom example there shows where if the function definition shows that if we have A and the second parameter is zero, we will always just return A. Now, it's important to remember when you use this kind of pattern matching that the ordering is very important. So this isn't ordered particularly well here, but it will basically, it's a bit like a case statement in most languages. The first one that it matches is the one that it will use. So I really love the pipeline operator. It's not particularly big and it's not particularly clever, but it does make for some nice looking code. And it's always good to start with an example with this. So I've made up some Ruby functions here before anybody says, because I couldn't figure out if there was any like Ruby things that I could use to change the strings without actually changing the string that I'm working on. But so I've made up these lowercase things and stuff. But as we see here, we start off with a nice string, hello world, all shouty with an exclamation at the end. We want to lowercase that and assign it to the first step intermediary variable. We want to title case it and assign that to the second step. And then we want to trim off the last, the bang, and assign it to the result. You can do exactly the same thing in Elixir. We're doing, you know, we're just using the functions that are available in the string module. However, if you wanted to, with the pipeline operator, you can actually start with hello world in a shouty form. You can pipe it directly to downcase, and you can pipe the output of that directly to capitalize, and you can pipe the output of that directly to trim trailing. And we also pass in another parameter to trim trailing, which is the thing that we're trying to trail off the end. I think it just makes the code look so much tidier for me. Simply put, all it does is the pipeline operator takes whatever the output of the first function call, and or the, whatever the output of the first expression is, into the first parameter of the next function call. And it makes it look better, and it also it allows you to a lot more easily insert things into that pipeline, because you don't have to start like creating new variables and then renaming which ones are going into which. Hey, Alistair.
If trim trailing took the second step as the second parameter, is there a way to kind of tell it with the pipe you actually want the second parameter to be put?
No, it's always the first parameter. Alrighty.
Is Elixir support, like, is that some type of sugar, or is that actually Elixir supports like arguments or?
I'm gonna pass on that. The thing, well, I was going to say there's a lot of Elixir is actually implemented in macros, which I'm not going to touch on, but a lot of the language itself is implemented in, you know, by writing macros in Elixir, and so it could well be that that's just a macro. What do you think?
There's a single import that you can do which makes other functions curryable, so if you have all the arguments, it's busy. So it has currying, but it's sort of like an extension.
Cool. I like curry too. Sorry, you might remember earlier I said that there's no state in Elixir. Now, that's not true, really. You know, there has to be some form of state, otherwise life is just going to be too difficult to even bother with. The best way I've found to handle state in Elixir is with message passing. So the Erlang VM, it can spawn multiple lightweight processes, and each process can communicate with other processes by sending it messages. And each process has its own mailbox into which it receives messages. And at that point, you can send a process messages and nothing will happen. But if you have if you've set up a receive call in your process, you can actually get it to wait for a message that meets a particular pattern or matches a particular pattern. So when you get a message that meets that pattern, you will execute the body that's associated with it. It's actually like a case statement. You get multiple, you can, when you set up the receive, you can set multiple patterns and multiple execution paths for those. So, one thing I should say first is when you set up the receive, if it will go through the mailbox looking for matches. If it doesn't find any matches, it will effectively just sit there blocking In that process, that will, you know, the scheduler will handle that for you, don't worry. And it will wait until a match comes along. So it's a bit like a hopeless romantic of a process. So in this example, I've given an example of the receive statement. So we have this like little process that is going to manage incrementing a counter for us. We can set that up really simply by just saying we want to receive the message increment, and when we do so, we want to start with the state we have and add one to it and assign it to the new state. But that only processes the one message that we get in, so it only works for one increment, and then that bit of code will do nothing after that. So very simply, we have that in a function. We call it loop for convenience, if you can call it whatever you want. And every time you process the message, the last thing you do is call loop, and you'll go back around and wait for the next message that matches. Still a problem here. If state is say a zero, it's going to be zero every time we go in here, and we're not actually going to do anything except set it to one and then forget about it and then come back around at zero again. So what we do is we send in the state initially. So we send a state of zero in when you first call loop, and when you've assigned one, or when you've incremented state by one, you assign it to new state, and then you call loop with the new state, and that will come back around again. So it's a little bit tricksy. In some ways it's a bit convoluted, but I think that's one of the advantages of it, because when you can store state anywhere the hell you like in your programming language, you start doing that. If there's a way of holding a bit of state here or a bit of there, you know, I'll just create more of these, you know, like static variables or things like that. The problem is then you start getting little pockets of state all over your app, and it's so easy to do it. It's easy to forget that you've got them. With this kind of approach, you have to think about it. You have to be sure that you want to store that state. So I find it's like a little bit of a sanity check before you go to do anything. Recursion is quite important to the Elixir world. For many developers, recursion is a thing to avoid, and for some good reasons. They can be hard to follow. You know, if you're trying to debug a recursive function, it can be a pain in the backside. And they can also be dangerous if they're not carefully managed. So if your recursion gets out of control, you could end up blowing your stack very easily. So Elixir not only makes the recursion possible, but it also it makes it an essential part of the ecosystem, because you don't have a while loop. There is a for, but it's not the for that we're used to in a lot of other languages. And the reason why is because we use recursion instead. It does have a few saving graces that make recursion a wee bit easier to understand and also a little safer. The first thing that it can offer us is the conditional functions. We looked at those earlier, but here we're doing it with a recursive function. And we know that, say, for example, we have a data structure that contains maps, lists, and other variable types. We can create a recursive function call that only operates whenever you've got a map. We can create another one that only operates when you've got a list. And we can create another one that will handle everything else. So that makes it easier. You can start breaking your code out into different code paths, and that will help with understanding what's going on, as opposed to having lots of like case statements within a single function that sends you in lots of different directions. Also, the other thing that Elixir provides so that you don't necessarily blow your stack is tail call optimization. So when that happens, you basically will, if you call the same function again, instead of creating a new stack frame, it will reuse the existing one and put in your new state. This is something a lot of languages are doing, and it's a really good thing, because if you've seen some of the stuff we have in our code where it just dips, tail call optimization is something we would really like to do. The one thing, the caveat of this is it has to be the last thing you do in your function. It has to be the last, because if you don't, it doesn't, you know, it just won't work. All right, now the holy war bit, your dev environment for Elixir. So first of all, how do you get started? For Mac, it's fairly easy. As long as you've got Brew installed on your machine, you can just Brew install Elixir. For Linux, you can look for your normal, you might have a package for it with your distribution, in which case you could do a yum install, or you could do an apt-get install, or I'm not sure what they do these days. As usual, there's an installer package for Windows. And if you want to pretend it's like 2002, you can do a sort of make clean test and just get it straight from GitHub. There's no official development environment for Elixir. And that's probably because everything's nice and clean. It's just plain text. Any text editor or an operating system that's masquerading as a text editor like Emacs will probably do. As you might expect, there's plenty of support in Elixir or for Elixir in Vim. You get syntax highlighting and completions and lots of the usual stuff. I think Stephen mentioned earlier that there's alchemy. Some, you know, that offer, you know, like integration with C tags and like the ability to jump between files, and that sounds good. So I'm going to have a wee go at that. Atom support's particularly good. I like it. There's auto completion, syntax highlighting, and it has an integration with a linter, and so I can get nice like messages telling me that I'm just writing really bad Elixir right in my editor. I don't have to go anywhere else to find out how bad I am. You've got Visual Studio Code. It lags a little bit behind Atom. It's got syntax highlighting and various bits of language support, but that's about it. And if you really, really want to work in an IDE, you can always download IntelliJ, and there's a community plugin for Elixir. And it's not bad, but it just, you know, like it doesn't have the full integrated feel that you would expect from an IDE. And so what you're really doing is running a huge Java-based editor. How do you build Elixir applications? So if you're planning just to run a few short scripts, you can easily do that by just at your command line writing the Elixir command and passing in the name of the script. By convention, Elixir scripts will end in .exs. If you're planning to do something more substantial, your best approach is to use the mix command line tool that the Elixir distributions provide. So mix is a build tool, and it has a lot of influences really. It can be used to build and test your app. So in that way, it's a bit like make, but it also can be used to manage your dependencies. And in that way, it's a bit like something like Bundler or NuGet or I can't think of any, NPM or something like that. And then it's also like it can be used to then create new projects or even create resources within your project. So in that sense, it's kind of like the Rails command line tool. So you can use it to build your scaffold and all that sort of thing. If you're wanting to create a new project, you just do mix new and then your project name. And if you want to see all the things it supports, you just type in mix help and it will list all the tasks that are available to it. You can also add more tasks to your mix project. Your dependencies can bring more stuff in. So if you, for example, are using Phoenix, it will bring in a whole load of extra things for mix to do for you. Does it have a REPL? It does. The Elixir REPL is called IEX, and it's available if you just type IEX at the command line. So you can run it standalone and just get stuck in, start writing some code, and that's great. Or you can launch your applications directly into it. So it's pretty common for people to just start IEX with their mix.exs file, which is the configuration for your project, and just do that with IEX minus S for script, and then just mix. And that will take your configuration in, loads up all the modules that you need, and allows you to work with that code straight from the REPL. So, running the applications, if you can use mix compile to build them, and that'll create a collection of like .beam files, which is a bit like the .class files from Java, and those, you know, you'll get one for each module, and that will get you can load those into the VM, the beam, in order to run your code. But how do you start that the beam itself? That kind of depends on what kind of application you're writing. For a script, you don't really need to pre-compile anything. So if you just, as I said earlier, do Elixir and your script name. It'll compile your code into bytecode. It'll start the beam up and load that bytecode in and start executing it. And then it'll clean everything up once the script's over and done with. and that you don't have to do much else. Now, if you want to create a command line tool, for example, something that's a bit more than just one script, you can bundle it up as what they call an e-script. You add a little bit of configuration to your mix.exs file to give it the name of a module that you want to be your entry point. And as long as you've defined within that module a function called main, that will get called, that will get executed and pass the command line arguments in. You can just build that up using mix escript.build, and it will dump out a binary into your project directory. Now the binary is not, it's not a portable binary, really. Technically, it has the Elixir stuff built into it, but it still needs the Erlang VM installed on your machine. So I'm not sure how portable that really is, because chances are if you've installed Erlang, you might have already installed Elixir as well. If you're wanting to create a server process, then you can make a different modification to your mix.exs by adding an application entry point or an application callback function using the mod key. So this function or this module needs to have a start function in it that takes two parameters, and that will be executed whenever you type mix run. And like any self-respecting programming language, Elixir comes with its own XUnit style of testing. In this case, it's literally called XUnit. Every new project that Mix creates for you will come with an example test that will summarize what it's about. I've sort of condensed it here. You create a new module. The name test at the end is, as far as I know, just a convention. You tell it to use this xunit.case, which is how it knows that it's to run as a test. And you can do your, just define your test, define assertions, and this doc test I'll touch on in a wee minute. You can also use like describe constructs to make it more like spec style testing. So tests themselves, you put them into files, name them as script files, .exs, and they'll get picked up. As long as they're in the test directory, they'll get picked up by Mix whenever you do Mix test. So doc tests, I mentioned, Elixir code supports doc comments, so you can add in your comments, and you know, every function can be documented so that it actually can come up in the REPL if you type help on the function name and that sort of thing. But so one thing you can do with your doc comments is you can add in a call, you can add in example calls for the REPL itself and example output from those calls for in the REPL. And if you have that, what I had in the previous slide, that doc test module, that will tell it to test the module and test the documentation comments to make sure that the example that you've given for IEX actually produces the output that you've given for IEX as well. So that means you can help to make sure that your tests, the comments are staying kind of relevant to what the function of the code actually does. And it should help with avoiding comment rot. Dependency management is done by a package manager called Hex. Unlike most, not most, but many package managers, Hex is actually a first-class citizen in the Elixir world. And if you want to use it, you just need to include a dependency like this into your mix.exs file. When you do so, when you try to run your, or when you've got this in your configuration file, you Mix will be able to tell that you've got dependencies, and it will bring Hex in the action. So if you don't have Hex, it'll go and get it, and then it will run it to make sure that you can get your dependencies, pull them down, and put them into a directory in your project, and they'll be ready for you to build. It drops them into a folder called deps, which is, it's probably worth not committing that to your repo unless you really want to. It's also very closely coupled to the Elixir documentation system, Hex itself, and there's a hexdocs.pm website that has third-party module docs, but also all the Elixir docs are now, the official Elixir language docs are held there as well. So to wrap up, Elixir, it's a modern, concurrent, functional programming language that compiles down to bytecode that is suitable for execution on the Erlang VM. Relies on many years of development put into the Erlang VM to provide a scalable, distributed, and fault-tolerable execution environment. personally, I really enjoy working with it. There's something I enjoy about it. I don't know if it's because I'm dabbling with functional languages and this is my entry point, or if there's something particularly about Elixir, but I really enjoy working with it, and I think you might too. Got some links and resources here. We'll publish these slides somewhere, and you can pick them all up from there. Thank you.